my name is Marek. I will be talking about property-based testing. I'll tell you what it is later. And I work for Mews. And for those who don't know, Mews is a company that has development in Prague and develops systems for the hospitality industry. So we can imagine this as a central system that you have in a hotel for managing reservations, customers, all that kind of stuff. All right, so let's start with a recap of why automated tests can be good for us, right? I'm sure many of you already use and write some automated tests and are convinced about their superiority to manual testing, but just to recap a little, there are some reasons why I write automated tests and why they are better than manual tests, right? So one of the reasons can be that they are much faster to execute compared to a manual test. Another reason might be that they just simply don't forget about testing some use cases, right? Because when you're executing tests manually, it means that you can easily make a mistake. And this doesn't happen with a suite of automated tests, right? Also, another reason for using them might be that they help you prevent regression. I'm sure that everybody's been through the experience of reintroducing some bug that they previously fixed. So, you know, if you fix a bug and write a test for it, you avoid regression of that bug. And also the test can serve as a very good documentation because they show you how a piece of code is supposed to be used, right? So there's like many reasons why writing automated tests can help us. And in this talk, I will show you a little bit different approach to writing automated tests than you may already know. So the standard approach that most people are using is called, or I will call it, example-based testing, right? And it composes of three simple steps. So the first step of writing an example-based test is just defining some values, right? I look at my code that I want to test, and based on code, I just figure out what some input values might be and work with them later. Then I look at the values that I have, I look at the code and what it's supposed to do, and I write down some expected output values, right? And as a third step, I execute my code and check that the output matches the expected values. So this is the standard approach. All right, so let's have an example that we are going to be working with for the rest of the presentation. And that is basically a simple list traversal function, right? It's a simple function that just takes an ordered collection of integers and is supposed to return you a collection of the same integers, just in the opposite order, right? Like a very simple function. So how would we approach writing a test for such a function? Well, using the standard approach, it might look like this, right? We first define the input, then we call the function, and then we pretty much verify that the actual output of the function matches some expected value. So that's good enough, but it doesn't really guarantee that the function works with all kinds of inputs, right? It works with this one input, but it may not work well with others. So, you know, there might be some edge cases. So let's say that we also want to test if it works correctly with an empty collection, right? So we might end up with something like this. We might just copy the case that we already had and change the input and expected output, right? So there might be suddenly two cases, but with most functions, there are going to be more edge cases than this. So we're gonna end up with like a lot of cases. Of course, we can do some refactoring. So for example, we can abstract some common code out of those test cases, but we will still have to write them manually, right? All of them. And we will still have to maintain the code that is the actual test, right? I know that some testing frameworks can actually help us reduce the amount of code a lot, but it still doesn't reduce the amount of work that we need to do. We still need to figure out what the cases for the test should be. So is there any better solution to this, actually? Well, there is, and that's called property-based testing. The steps to writing a property-based test are a little different than steps to writing an example-based test. So let's go through them now. So the first step is that we describe the input in some way, but in this case, it doesn't mean defining the specific values that we want to run the test with. It just means describing what the input should look like, right? I will show you an example of this later. The second step is describing the properties of the code that we are going to test, right? This is a little bit tricky, especially figuring out what those properties are is a little bit tricky, but again, that will be covered in an example later. And as the last step, we just run the test, but we have a computer auto-generate the input values for us based on the description that we provided in the first step, and then we just verify that those properties actually apply, right? So this might seem a little abstract, but I have a few examples of this. So in order to be able to write a property-based test, basically, we need to define some properties of the code that we are going to test. So just as a simple example on this list reversal function, one of the properties can be that if we call it twice, we get the original input, right? So, you know, I reverse a list and then I reverse that reversed list again and I get the original list. So a very simple property. So how would we actually write a test like this? Well, based on what I showed before or what I said before, it might look like this, right? We might start with actually auto-generating some input because I said, the tests are basically based on auto-generated input. So I might write code that generates the input manually, just like this, right? So that's the first step. The second step is calling the function twice, right? So I reverse a list and then I reverse the output again. And the third step is actually verifying that the list, that the double reversed list is equal to the original list again, right? And just to make sure that that I have a higher chance of basically catching some edge cases, I just run the test 100 times, right? So this is basically the simplest example of a property-based test. And these tests are often called generative tests, right? So exactly for the reason that this example shows, and that is that the input is generated automatically. Well, this is certainly a way of writing the tests like this, but it has some disadvantages, right? So let's see what they are. Let's say that my implementation of the list reversal function was incorrect and doesn't work in some cases, right? So I might end up with something like this. Some sort of an error that I will see when running the code, but it just doesn't really tell me much. Like, I don't know what's wrong, and I don't know, most importantly, I don't know which input it failed on, right? So that's one reason not to actually implement everything manually. Of course, you could always say that after adding some logging, you might see what cases it failed on, but there's other things that need to be solved, right? For example, since we're generating the values completely randomly, we are not sure that it will cover all edge cases, right? Because I was still in charge of basically defining what the range for the random values is. So I might not cover everything, right? So for that reason, there is a way to write the test using a library. And that library was originally called QuickCheck, and QuickCheck was a library, or is a library, that was implemented in Haskell, and basically it was the first library for writing property-based tests. But as you can see on this list, there's like many other languages that now have a port of QuickCheck. It's usually under different names, but whatever language out of these, I suppose, you are using, it doesn't matter. You can use a library to write property-based tests, right? So let's show some examples using a library for .NET. All right, so let's take this a little slowly. So if we want to implement a property-based test using the library, here we have a template for it, right? So basically, what this code does is basically an empty template for a test that will verify a property that should be true for all list of integers, right? I don't have to specify any values. I don't have to write any code that will generate the values. The library does it all for me. So I just say that I just specify the type of the input values that I'm expecting, and I can start writing my test. Just to show what the library is able to generate, I've put here an example of a log that is provided by the library and that shows some values that the library auto-generated for me. All right, so let's extend it a little and let's write the actual test, right? So now I have the list provided by a generator that is part of the library, so I don't have to care about the way I generate the numbers. I can just run my code, right? So once again, I am reversing a list and then I'm reversing the output of that previous call for a second time, and I'm comparing the original input to the double reverse list, right? And basically that's it. The function is supposed to return a bool, which it's doing, and the framework does everything else for me, right? One last thing that I need to do is actually call the test with some configuration, but that's not really important. All right, so what happens when I run the test? Well, it might turn out to be green, right? So that means that for any list, the property that we described before holds true, right? So that's fine. So what happens if we actually look at the implementation of reverse? Well, we might find something like this, right? And that doesn't look like a proper implementation, but it passes the test. So this nicely shows that with property-based tests, you usually need to define more than a single property, because just a single property isn't enough to properly describe a function, right? So let's actually solve this by extending our test suite with a second property. And this one is a little more complicated, but still not too much. So basically, I can also say that if I append an element to the list that I had and I reverse that list, it's the same as reversing that list first and then prepending an element at the beginning of the list, right? So I can write a test that basically verifies this, right? So this one is a little more complicated, because now I need not only one input value, but I need two of them. So one of them is going to be the element that I'm going to be appending or prepending, and the other one is going to be the list. So pretty much the same as what I had with the previous test. All right, so now I'm pretty much ready to write the actual test, right? So I can just add the actual implementation. You can see on the first line of the test that I'm doing exactly what I showed you on the diagram. I'm appending an element to the list, and I'm reversing the list with the element, right? And then on the second line, or the line below that, I'm first reversing the list and then preparing the element. And then again, as the last step, I'm just verifying that these two values are equal, right? Well, if I run the test now with the implementation that I showed you before, the test will fail. So that's a good sign, because the implementation wasn't that correct, right? So what do I do now? Well, I just fix the implementation, right? Since this is a really simple function, I'm just gonna use some framework function to reverse the list. And if I do this and I rerun the test, they're both green. And, you know, if I suppose that I define my properties correctly, then this should be give me like high enough confidence that this function actually works correctly, right? And it not only works on some list that I would define at first, but it works on any list, basically. The library that we're using is able to generate some basic types of values, and it's also able to ensure that these values cover the edge cases, right? So in case you're generating strings, this might be empty strings. In .NET, it might be nulls. It might be strings that are very long, stuff like this. So, you know, it can help you discover a lot of edge cases that your code might not count with, right? So let's look at, let's take a step back and look at the result of the test that didn't actually pass before, right? So the framework or the library, as you can see here, can give you some info about the test that it ran and that failed, right? So versus when we wrote the test manually, we didn't have all of this. So basically, it gives you information about the values it verified the properties with, and it can clearly show you what values it failed on. So basically, you don't have to do any manual logging. All right. When I'm mentioning tools that are provided by the library, one of them is called a shrinker. So what a shrinker does is that in case the testing library finds some values that your code doesn't work with or doesn't work with correctly, these values might be like really huge, right? And what the purpose of the shrinker is to reduce that to the lowest possible values that doesn't pass your test, right? So a shrinker is like a really simple piece of code that based on trial and error gets to the lowest value that will fail your code. Another thing provided by the library is the seed. And seed are basically just two numbers, two values that you can use to reproduce a run that was executed by the framework, right? So let's say that my test start failing and I want to debug it. So basically, in order to debug it, I don't have to copy all the input values. I just need to copy these two values, and basically, I can rerun the test again, this time specifying the seed. And basically, when I do this, I will get to the exact state that was generated by the library when running the test. So hopefully I've shown that property-based tests can be useful, but I will admit that they are sometimes difficult to write. Sometimes it's just difficult to figure out what the properties of the functions are, right? So there are some common strategies for this. I will show just a few of them that I've actually found useful in practice, but there's many more. So the first one is called fast testing. And basically, this is just verifying that our code works with all the inputs that it can receive, right? Because it often happens that basically we write some code and then later in production we figure out that it doesn't work correctly with some input values that we should have been able to foresee, but we weren't, right? So this is pretty much just checking that the code works and doesn't crash on some weird values. So the second strategy for writing these tests can be an inverse using an inverse function, right? So in our example of the reverse function, basically reverse is already that function, but oftentimes you have a pair of functions. Well, so as an example of this, we have functions that can encode a value and then decode value back, right? Or we have a serialization and deserialization functions. Or even functions that write data and then read the data again, right? So the test can basically verify that any input that goes to the first function can later go to the second function, and I get the original input back. another strategy can be idempotent functions. Pretty much idempotent functions are pretty easy. The main premise here is that once I call the function once, it doesn't matter if I call it many times again, right? The pretty much output of the first call is the same as output of any other subsequent call, right? Sometimes we are trying to achieve this, but it doesn't always work out the way we want to. So property-based tests can also be used for verifying this property. And the last strategy that I actually personally found very useful is called test oracle. Basically, what this strategy is about is that you already have a working implementation of what you want to test, right? Sometimes that can be like an old implementation of something that you are sure works correctly and that you are trying to rewrite, right? So basically what you do here is that you just verify that for any input that worked with your old implementation, the new implementation gives the same output, right? You just call both and compare the output and see if they differ or not. So this can even be used for like a naive version of some algorithm, which is usually, you know, not that performant, has some issues, but the benefits are that it's easily readable. Well, if you want to optimize such implementation, you will probably end up with some code that is not that easily readable. It is actually hard to catch bugs in it. So in that case, you can once again, call both implementations and compare the outputs, right? And because you're getting the auto-generated values that should cover different edge cases, this should show you if they are really the same or if there are some cases where they differ. All right, so let's wrap this up with some quick summary. So there's just a couple of points that I wanted to highlight. And the first one is that it's often beneficial to combine example-based test and property-based test. I'm not saying that property-based tests are a complete replacement for example-based tests, but it's often like really, really good to combine these. The second point is that example-based tests have an advantage over a property-based test in that they are much easier to understand. It depends on the test, but it's often the case that they are easier to understand. And if you remember the documentation aspect of automated tests, that works better with example-based tests in most of the cases. But another advantage in writing property-based tests can be that just a few property-based tests, or only one in some cases, can replace many example-based tests, right? So you have to write less code, and you need to maintain less code. So there are some advantages to that. And the last advantage that I want to mention, and probably the biggest one, is that generative tests are more likely to discover some edge cases, right? Because when you're writing example-based tests, you need to figure out what the input will be, what outputs you're expecting. But in some cases, you just write code and you forget that it should handle this and this and that scenario, right? So if you need to write the tests manually, they don't help you with that. Generative tests will generate the values for you, so they will discover some deficiencies that might be there. All right, so just some useful resources can be, you can find them here. The first one is that if you want to know more about this, I definitely can recommend visiting fsharpforfunandprofit.com. Which is a website about F#, but it has one or two very nice tutorials for writing property-based tests, and it also shows some strategies for figuring out what the properties are, right? Then you can check out Wikipedia of QuickCheck. That's where I got the list of languages that have some library for writing property-based tests. This is mainly useful because you can find a library for your language there. And in case you're interested in the slides for the talk, you can find them on my GitHub and the QR code leads there. So yeah, that's it. Yeah, so if you have any questions. It's on the Slido. Do you use automated tests as documentation? How do you transfer the test results to readable documentation? If the answer is yes, we do. All right. To be honest, we don't write that many unit tests. So we have like a much bigger suite of integration tests. But we actually do have some unit tests that serve as a very good documentation, mainly for our financial core. But we don't do anything special to actually emphasize this aspect of it. We just usually have a well-named test case that basically, you know, tells you by the name what it's supposed to do, and by seeing the code, you can probably see how it works or how it's supposed to work. If that answers that question, is testing using quick check deterministic? So this depends. If you actually follow the right patterns, it is. That was obvious by the seed example that I showed you before, and that only works because they are deterministic, right? But I've seen incorrectly written property-based tests that are using some custom generators that are not actually based on the seed. And if you do that, then they are not deterministic, and you are basically losing a big advantage of quick check. So there are some ways to, like, correct ways to write custom generators in a way that they will work with the seed. The next one is property-based testing the superior approach to unit testing in all cases, in your opinion? If not, when is a different approach better? Well, I don't think it is the superior approach. I think it can complement example-based tests very nicely, but it's often like really difficult to figure out what properties of a function are, right? It can sometimes help you to think about this. It can help you realize what you're actually expecting from the function that you're testing, but it's not always possible, or like it's not always easy. So I would say it's good to combine those two approaches. So have you tried using AI for generating the test data? No, I have not. But I'm not sure if this question wasn't for the talk before. Probably not. How hard is for a newcomer to understand what the test is actually testing? Well, this depends on the test, right? And on the way it is written. You can help this a lot by naming your test cases correctly. You know, if you name a test case in a way that it says, if I have called this function and it's supposed to do this, then it's usually not that difficult to understand. But I will admit that with some of these tests, it can be pretty complex, especially if they have complicated input, it can be difficult. So I guess good naming and possibly comments can help a lot. Considering that tests run are generated, who is supposed to fix the failed test case when it's coming from some code I didn't change? And a workflow tips. Well, in practice, it usually starts failing early on. It doesn't happen very often that you add a test, it passes, and it starts failing later on, right? It usually starts failing upon some code change. And in that case, the author of the change is responsible for fixing it or for figuring out what is actually wrong. It's actually pretty reliable. So the next one, is the auto testing able to identify the worst case scenario if the inputs are random? Well, there are some strategies for pretty much trying different inputs. These are handled automatically by the library, and you know, this can be basically that when I'm generating a value, I want to try some extremes, right? And it's mostly known for common data types what the extremes are. So basically, for integers, I know that I want to try negative, positive, zero, some huge values, some really small values, stuff like this. So basically, if I'm testing with some more complex input, it's usually composed of these more primitive types as well, right? So even though I have some complex data type, it is composed of some primitive types, and for those primitive types, I have some generators that the library knows how to handle already, right? So in that case, it's able to generate the complex type with some edge cases inside it. And that is the approach that is used to find errors. So next one, what about performance if you have hundreds of tests like this? GUnit tests should run very fast as you can run them frequently. Can it be an issue? I have to admit that we don't have a huge number of these tests, but we do have some pretty complex ones that have some complex input, and pretty much performance is not an issue for us. But as you might have noticed in some of the slides, the tests do take longer to run. They don't run in units of milliseconds. They run in some hundreds of milliseconds, or possibly they could run in seconds, I can imagine, but it hasn't been an issue for us. But I can imagine that like a very large test suite will take some time to run. Next one, how do you see generative tests for functions, which ingest complex data types? Can you define input type schema or infer the tested properties from input type? So basically, what the framework allows you to do is to define some custom generators. That's one thing. The other thing is that for some complex inputs, it can already figure out that they are composed of some types, some more primitive types that it already knows. So it's able to generate those inputs as well. And the second part of the question, can you define input type schema or infer the tested properties from input type? Yeah, I guess I covered the input type schema, hopefully, but I'm not sure about inferring the tested properties from input type. Guess that's all, like defining the properties is always up to the developer. And basically, if you look at a definition of a function, you can see what the input is, right? And based on that, you can think about what the actual implementation is supposed to do with different inputs. And you know, the conclusion might be that you will restrict the input of a function to pretty much simplify the whole thing. All right, next one. You are using other function to describe your properties. How do you know they are working correctly? That is a good point. I guess that's a problem, or might be a problem, with all kinds of tests, right? If you make a mistake in the test, you might end up with a test that doesn't test anything at all. But I don't actually have some solution to this other than basically just doing code reviews on even the test code, right? It's better to actually review test code as well, just to make sure that the tests that you edit are actually testing something. What's the language of text examples? I forgot to mention that. It's C#. and everything is done in FSCheck, which is the library for writing tests in .NET or property-based tests in .NET. Did you try Spock framework? No, to be honest, I have never heard of it. It seems like property-based testing is just normal automated testing, but with auto-generated input. What's the benefit? Well, yeah, that's right. The benefit of this is that you don't have to write the input yourself, which saves you some work, hopefully, and that the input that you get from the generator might include some values that you wouldn't think of. So these are the main benefits. And the last one, are the inputs the same random values when I run in CI? Do you log them by some seed? Yeah, so basically when writing the test, you don't specify any seed and you are working with some seed that gets auto-generated. But you know, if it happens that such a test fails in your CI, you will usually have some log in there. And in that log, you can find the seed that was used to run the test. And you can just take that seed and run the test locally again. And since it's all deterministic, you will get to the same test, to the same state that happened when running the test, right? So you will be able to debug it on your local machine or do whatever else you need to do to figure out where the problem is. All right. So that's it. Thank you.